नमस्कार, वेलकम टू दिस फोर्थ एंड द फाइनल सेशन ऑफ द 18th अध्याय ऑफ श्री भगवद गीता। वी स्टार्ट विद द ग्रैटिट्यूड टुवर्ड्स द लॉर्ड विथ हूज ग्रेस एवरीथिंग इज पॉसिबल। वी प्रे टू द गुरु शिष्य परंपरा, द लीनेज थ्रू विच दिस नॉलेज इज ट्रांसफर्ड फॉर जनरेशन सो एज टू रीच अस। आई पे माई रिस्पेक्ट्स टू माई गुरु जी पूज्य गुरु मा विथ हूज ग्रेस आई एम एबल टू लर्न द स्क्रिप्चर्स एंड शेयर दिस अंडरस्टैंडिंग विथ यू। Start with the prayer. Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So the 18th adhyaya is the summary of the entire Bhagavad Gita. It is also called the Moksha Sannyasa Yoga. That is how we can attain Moksha, the final goal, final destination for all of us, by Tyaga, by renunciation. And the method of teaching of Vedanta and Upanishad, of which Gitaji is the Tatparya, the summary or the crux of the message, is that first it will outline, Bhagwan already in the second Adhyaya has given the Sankshep summary of the entire, you know, Upadesha or the teachings of Gitaji in the second Adhyaya about Jnana, Karma, Karma, Sannyasa, everything. And then in details they describe all the different aspects of the different sadhanas, the Karma Yoga, the Bhakti, the Dhyana Yoga, and then the Jnana, and how we can Sharanagati towards the Lord. Finally, in the 18th Adhyaya, now again, Bhagavan is trying to summarize the entire Sankshepa, the message, concluding the Gitaji by summarizing its message. And apart from this, there are many, many other important subjects that Bhagavan has touched upon in this Adhyaya. What is the different three types of Buddhi Shakti, Druti Shakti, Karma, Karta, Jnana, all this has been touched upon. And that's why it forms a very important part of the Adhyaya of the summary of Gitaji. So let us just recapitulate what we have seen in the last session. The third session of the 18th Adhyaya started with the Varna Dharma Nirupana, description of the Varnashrama Vyavastha of our ancient Sanatana Dharma, where the entire human class was distributed into four classes: the Brahmins, the Kshatriyas, the Vaishyas, and the Shudras. And then in the next four shlokas, Bhagavan described the natural, the guna karma of Brahmins, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra. And then started describing how with our own karma, our own natural duties that we are bound with, we can attain the ultimate siddhi, the ultimate goal of our life. And how he described this procedure, how we can surrender our actions to the worship of the Lord, swasva karmana tama abhyarcha, and we can go towards our duty. He also said that Shreyan Swadharmo Vigunaha Paradharmat Swanushtithat. Swadharma is the best. We should not follow others' dharma. We should not see what others are doing. We should just follow our own duty, what we have been given. And we have to change our attitude towards the karma. Bhagavan has repeatedly stressed this, that we don't have to give up karma, but we have to give up the karma phala. And this is what is called as a karma yoga. In karma yoga, the attachment towards our karma phala, the asakti towards our fruits of the actions, has to be renounced, but karmas need not be renounced and should not be renounced. And then Bhagavan described how with going gradually towards selfless actions, nishkam karma, we can go and then get the jnana and get into the akarma or the nishkarma state where there is actionlessness, how we can understand our akarta swarupa of our own self. And then in the next five shlokas, Bhagavan described the entire jnana sadhana, how from antakarana shuddhi, how we can go towards the jnana sadhana, the shravana, manana, nididhyasana, and finally the paroksha jnana, and then how it can become directly assimilated within us, a paroksha jnana, where we feel one with the Brahma. So paroksha jnana is Brahma asti, Brahma is there, whereas aparoksha jnana is Brahma asmi. Aham Brahma Asmi, I am that Brahma, I am that universal consciousness, which is the ultimate final goal for us to understand. And then after describing this in the 55th shloka, in the 56th shloka, Bhagavan again starts by describing that the Karma Yoga is the starting point, how we have to start this journey. He says, सर्व कर्माण्यपि सदा कुर्वाणो मद्व्यपाश्रयः मत्प्रसादाद वाप्नोति शाश्वतम पदम अव्ययम्। सो इट सेज ऑल एक्शंस ऑल सर्व कर्माणि ऑल अवर एक्शंस मस्ट बी मत व्यपाश्रयः मस्ट बी सरेंडर्ड मस्ट बी ऑफर्ड टू द लॉर्ड। He says, and then what will happen? Mat prasadat, by my grace, by my anugraha, anukampa, by my krupa, you will attain avapnoti shashvatam padam avyayam, which is the eternal and highest state, that is the Brahma, that is the universal consciousness, which one will attain that state. And that itself denotes to us that karma yoga, our own purushartha, is very, very important. If our purushartha is in the right direction, then Bhagwan's grace, what is also called as Parabdha or the Daivam, as he has already said before. And this will lead to Jnana Nishtha, and from Jnana Nishtha will lead to Moksha, the ultimate goal of the human life that our Shastras describe. In the 57th Shloka, Bhagavan also clearly states what we all need to do through Arjuna is the Madhyama, is the instrument. He describes what all we must do. He says, Chetasa Sarva Karmani, Sarva Karmani Mai Sanyasa, by surrendering all our actions to the Lord, by karma yoga chetasa. Chetasa means by understanding, by awareness, by alertness. We have to be alert about the way, the bhava of our karma. Mat paraha. Mat paraha means we have to be completely devoted to the Lord, surrender ourselves to the Lord, don't have attachments for the karma phala. And buddhi yoga upashritya. Use our intellect to do our karma, to understand that knowledge, to understand that samatva bhavana, karma yoga bhavana, that itself is buddhi yogam. And that we have to take ashraya, ashrita. We have to be surrendered to this intellect. And with this, we have to machitta satatam bhava. Keep, Bhagavan says, keep me always in your mind, or keep your mind in me, Bhagavan says. And this is the goal, machitta satatam bhava. All the time, be in contact, communion with the Lord. And in today's life, today's world, the best way is to do continuous chanting of the name of the Lord. Smarana itself is samarpana. While we do all our actions, we chant the name of the Lord, thinking that it is all His Krupa, His Prasada. And what happens, what is the benefit of this attitude? Machitta, Bhagavan says, Machitta Sarva Durgani Mat Prasadat Tarishyasi. Machitta, one who is always devoted to me, who always keeps his mind in me, who is always having surrenders to me, who always has, chanting my name. What happens to him? Mat Prasadat, with the Lord's grace, Sarva Durgani Tarishyasi. He crosses all the difficulties, obstacles on his path. Durga. Durga means a fort which is invincible, which is very difficult to get over. And our own Durga or our own difficulties, obstacles, mainly is avidya, ignorance, out of which all these shada, ripu, the kama, krodha, loha, moha, matsarya, all these arise. So these are all the difficulties which we will cross by his grace. Atatvam ahankarat. However, Bhagavan says, if you don't understand this, if you don't do this, if you follow your own egotism, your own pride, what will happen? Nashrosyasi, you do not listen to me because of your ego. Bhagavan says, Vinakshyasi, then you will be ruined, you will perish. And that itself means, does not mean that we'll be destroyed. Literally means we'll be destroyed, but destruction doesn't mean physical destruction. We'll be ruined from our state, means we will don't get a better, next janam or gati. Will be not be good, it will be adogati if you don't listen to the God. So Bhagavan is trying to tell us that ahankara is our main obstacle. We all operate from our mithya abhimana, which does not allow us to see the truth which is in front of it, and which once it is dissolved, this ahankara, this mithya abhimana, once it is dissolved, that gives us the purity of the mind that is important for the eligibility of this atma jnana. And Bhagavan again says, yada ahankaram ashritya. If you don't understand, because of your ahankara, you don't understand this, you take shelter of your own pride, and if you miss Bhagavan,
Bhagavan ends this entire subject by the Trayi Vishvich Guna.
In the beginning of the second adhyaya, when he said Vishada, he was in complete Vishada, he had Moha, and he says, Na Yotse, I don't want to fight this battle. And he went and sat in the backside of the chariot, the last shloka of the first adhyaya, that he put down his Gandiva,
all these things which are useful,
to understand, valuable to. And Bhagavan says, if this is your understanding, iti manyase means it is your manyata, it is your misunderstanding, this is your belief, it is not the reality, because you are taking the shelter of your moha, pride, and mithya esha vyavasayate. It is a purposeless endeavors. It is a mithya nishchaya. This decision of yours is not the correct. Bhagavan says, even then, even if you don't come to my shelter, you take shelter of your pride, but your own sanskara, your own dharma, or your own prakriti, which is a kshatriya dharma, is again going to inspire you into this battle. Arjuna, don't think that you will not be able to fight this battle. You definitely shall be. And Bhagavan in the next shloka says, Swabhava Jena Kaunteya. Hey Kaunteya, he says again, he's remembering, making him remember that he's a kshatriya by warrior. You are bound to your natural Swabhava Jena Nibaddha. You are bound to your natural actions. Svena Karmana, all created by your own prakriti, your own dispositions. Kartum Naichasi Yat Mohat, even if you don't desire to do this battle out of foolishness, moha, misinterpretation, karishyasi avasha apitat, you shall be forced into this battle. And that's why Bhagavan is trying to tell Arjuna that you are dependent on your prakriti, you are dependent on your nature, even though you don't want to fight, but you will be forced to fight because you are dependent on the nature. So now the question comes, whether can I change my nature, can I change my dhrada sanskara? And the answer is yes. The spiritual discipline, the entire spiritual religious discipline is meant for this kind of a change, to change our sanskara. And most important that Bhagavan tells us is acceptance, svikar of our prakriti. But this svikar that Guruji Acharya explains to us is not passive. It is not that after svikara we don't try to do anything, but it is an active acceptance, meaning even after accepting the final outcome, we have to try my best to improve what I can do, what is in my field of kshetra, I must try to do. So acceptance is not a denial for change, but it is actually a catalyst for change, so that it will inspire us into action and allow us to make a change in our life. And the change that we need to do is our changing our attitude. We don't have to change our outer karma, but we have to change our attitude of the karma, the actions, those duties that we have been enjoined with, we have been given with. And we have to try to convert this into karma yoga. And Bhagavan says this is the first step in your spiritual discipline. And we need to start this from our own actions. And then gradually over a period of time, we have to reach towards actionlessness from karma. We have to go to akarma. And that understanding of our akarma, which Bhagavan has already described in the fourth adhyaya, Jnana Karma Sannyasa Yoga, he has already described this. And this is essentially the two lifestyles, Lokesmin Dvidha Anishta, the Pravrutti Marg and the Nivrutti Marg. These are the two lifestyles that Bhagavan has described. But only through the Pravrutti Marg we can go to the Nivrutti Marg. So there are no two lifestyles, these are just one path that Bhagavan has described. Either we have to first start with the Pravrutti, the Karma Yoga, and then over a period of time go to Nivrutti, and then finally towards Jnana and Moksha. So this is the... And then Bhagavan in the next shloka, it's a beautiful shloka, it describes how Arjuna, you are dependent on the God, on the Ishwar also. And he says, Ishwara sarva bhutanam ritte sherjuna tishtati brahmayan sarva bhutani yantrarudhani mayaya. Bhagavan says, Ishwara sarva bhutanam ritte sher tishtati. Arjuna, oh Arjuna, Ishwara, Bhagavan is sitting inside the hearts of all the beings, not just humans, but all the beings, sarva bhutanam, as antaryami, as atma of the all the bhuta, Bhagavan is sitting inside. And what does he do sitting there? He says, Ramayan sarva bhutani. He makes all the beings go round and round to revolve them, as if we are sitting on a merry-go-round, you go round and round. How? He says, yantra rudhani, mayaya, as if we are sitting on a yantra, on a machine. And how he does this yantra rudhani? By his maya, by his maya shakti, that is his magical power that Ishwara possesses. And with this maya shakti, he keeps going all these beings from samsara chakra, it goes them round and round from one bud to the other, from one bud to the other. And though our shastra, our Vedas, Upanishads tell us that Ishwara is sarvatra, it is omnipresent, it is everywhere. But here Bhagavan is telling us that I'm sitting inside the hearts of all the beings, because Guruji explains to us that this is the place that we can attain, we can understand, we can prapti sthan hai, ye Bhagavan ka, Ishwar ka. And that's why Bhagavan is describing that, yes, Ishwara sarva bhutana mridde sheti stati, hey Arjuna. And that's why this is what we have to understand. It is like we are sitting on a Ferris wheel, and the controller of the Ferris wheel makes it on, and then we go round and round and round and round till he makes it off, or there's an auto timer that we come to a halt. Till that time we have to go round and round. Similarly, Ishwara, and another very beautiful example that Guruji explains to us is by the puppet show, the Kathputli show, where the Kathputlis that we see are akin to the Jiva, and the puppeteer, the person who handles these puppets, the puppeteer is like the Ishwar, who is not seen, is behind the curtain, is not seen, and then he handles all the Kathputlis, all the puppets. They go here and there, they keep doing all their work. One person hits the other hits the other one, they make love, they make war, everything. And Ishwara, the puppeteer, is the controller. And Jiva is the person, is the controlled. All the Jiva, all the beings are controlled. And they are controlled through this very small thread, which is generally not seen if we are seeing from a distance. But if we very go close and sukshma drashti, then we will understand that we are controlled by our own karma. Karma is a thread through which we are controlled. All our actions, all our future janmas, all is controlled by this invisible Maya Shakti of the Lord, through which we are controlled by the Ishwara. So this is how we can understand. And we have to understand this divine, and then we have to go to the surrender to this divinity. Bhagavan is telling in the next shloka, Tameva saranam gacha sarva bhavena bharata tat prasadat param shantim sthanam prapsyasi shashvatam. Bhagavan says, this divinity, which is Riddheshe, Arjuna as Antaryami, that divinity, take the shelter of that divine. Bhagavan says, sarva bhavena bharata, by all means, during all your actions, vyavahara, all your vision, all your, you know, every moment of your life, you take the shelter of that divine sitting inside. Tat prasada, by his grace, by his prasada buddhi, because that Ishwara is the seer, is the Atma inside, sitting inside. Param shantim prapsasi, you will attain the divine bliss, which is the best gift that God can give us, because Bhagavan ka khud ka swarup ye hai, ananda swarup, and that's what he can, he is so benevolent that he will pass on this best gift to us, will give us that shanti, that eternal bliss, that shanti in our self, and only with this we can become eligible to attain this eternal abode. Sthanam prapsyasi shashvatam, that shashvata, that eternal sthana, that state of moksha can only be attained by this param shanti. Once we have to become shant, only then we can understand this atma tattva, this divinity which is within us, which is within everything, which pervades all that we can see and feel in this world. And that is what Bhagavan is telling us. So Bhagavan is indirectly telling us that we should let go of our shelter of our ego misconceptions. Ishwar is watching us always, sitting inside. We should not try to do anything wrong, because we are always being watched as an antaryami from inside by the Ishwara sitting inside us. And that is what we need to understand. So the choice is mine. And the change by the spiritual discipline is definitely possible, but we should know where we have to make choices. The first area is where we want to endeavor, what is the pravritti, what is there where we have to retreat, what we should not do, what is nivritti. We also need to understand what are the karmas, the actions, the right actions, dharma karma, the nitya karma, the naimittika karma, what we need to perform, or the vihita karma, and what we should not do, the nishiddha karma, adharma karma, we should not do. We also need to make a choice, what is the right dharma, what is the adharma. We also need to imbibe moral values, the Daivi Sampatti, renounce the Asuri Sampatti. All this has already been said in the Gitaji in several chapters. And we need to understand that we are bound by the natural laws. We are dependent on these natural laws, Paratantra. Say for example, Karma Phala is a natural law on which we have no control. It is determined by the Ishwara. But we have certain areas, we have a freedom to choose. We have a Purushartha, we have the Swatantrata, we have the freedom to choose. And this discrimination, Viveka, we need to do, because it is very, very important for our own benefit, for living a better life. And that's why in our life, we will always have two choices to choose from. One is the worldly or the prayer benefit. And the second is the divinity, the Shreya, the Kalyana, the Hita Marga. And we have to take those choices, and that will make our life. Next shloka, Bhagavan says, he concludes his message to mankind. He says, Iti te jnanam akhyatyam guhyat guhyataram maya vimrushyeta dadeshena यथेच्छसि तथा कुरु। भगवान सेज इति ते ज्ञानम आख्यात्यम मया, दिस नॉलेज एंटायर नॉलेज आई हैव गिवन यू एंड इट सेज व्हिच इज गुह्यात गुह्यतरम व्हिच इज द मोस्ट मिस्टिकल ऑफ द मिस्टीरियस व्हिच इज द बेस्ट केप्ट हिडन सीक्रेट व्हिच यू हैव नॉट नोन सो फार विमृश्ये एतत् अशेषेण मीन्स दैट यू थिंक अबाउट इट स्मरण करो अप यू नो थिंक अबाउट इट इन टोटालिटी अशेषेण मीन्स कंप्लीटली इन टोटालिटी डोंट जस्ट टेक वन सेंटेंस आउट ऑफ इट एंड मेक अ मीनिंग बट सी द एंटायर थिंग इन द राइट पर्सपेक्टिव अप्रोप्रिएटली यथा इच्छसी तथा करो एंड डू वट एवर यू फील इज अप्रोप्रिएट। भगवान इज नाउ गिविंग द चॉइस टू अर्जुन इज टेलिंग अर्जुन दैट यू नो आई हैव गिवन यू वट एवर आई वॉन्टेड टू आई हैव टोल्ड यू द एंटायर this mystical knowledge now you take your own decision think about it in totality what I have said in all these adhyayas and then this is how a great teacher this is acharya dharma gives freedom to the student and this freedom to the student comes out of the trust for the student that the student has understood this properly and will take the right decision in the best interest of his or her own self and with this bhagwan tells arjuna yatha ichchasi tatha kuru do whatever you feel is appropriate arjuna I have already told you this most mystical secret knowledge and then in the next shloka again bhagwan out of compassion tells arjuna okay wait I will still summarize entire gita ji in two shlokas he says sarva guhyatamam bhuyah shrunu me paramam vachah ishto si me dradamiti tato vakshyami te hitam He says, earlier he said, guhyat guhyataram. Now he says, sarva guhyatamam, the highest hidden secret, the knowledge, Bhagavan says, bhuya shrunu me paramam vacha. Listen again, bhuya shrunu means listen again to this paramam vacha, to my divine words. Bhagavan says, ishta asi, because you are so dear to me, I want to tell you again, because I love you, Arjuna. And Arjuna has this daivi sampatti, and that's why Bhagavan likes him, is so dear to him. Me dhadamiti, this is my firm conclusion, my final opinion. Tatah vakshyami, that's why I'm telling you again and again. He says, why am I telling you? Te hitam, for your own good benefit, for your upliftment, for your shreya, for your kalyana, for your hita, for your goodness, for your benefit. I'm telling you again, this my final message. I'm summarizing again in two shlokas and I'm going to tell you. Bhagavan says again, Arjun, listen carefully, my words. And the next shloka, Bhagavan summarizes the entire pravritti marg, the karma yoga message in one shloka. Manmana bhava mad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mame vaishyasi satyam te pratijane priyosi me. So Bhagavan says, manmana bhava, you keep me always in your mind, Arjuna. And this is possible. We have already seen this by constantly having smarana, chanting of the name of the Lord. Second, he says, Madbhakta Bhava. Madbhakta Bhava means be devoted to me, Arjuna, love me, respect me, bhakti karo. And there are several ways we can do bhakti. It could be saguna bhakti, nirguna bhakti, it could be puja, seva, archana, kirtan, manana, all these dhyana, chintana, all these are forms of different forms of devotion. Bhagavan says, Madhyaji Bhava. Surrender all your actions to me. And that is the message of the karma yoga. That we have to tam abhyarcha, we have to, you know, ashrita towards the Lord. Mam namaskuru, take my shelter, sharanagati, surrender to me for everything. Bhagavan says, mam eva eshyasi. If you do all these four, Bhagavan says, you shall attain me only thereafter. That is satyam te pratijane. This is my satya pratignya. This is my honest pledge that you will definitely attain me if you do all this, what I have told you. And this is what I'm telling you again and again, because priyo asi me, you are so dear to me, Arjuna. Through Arjuna, Bhagavan is telling all the jivas that you are very dear to me. Please do this. And I'm already always there. You shall always attend me. I'm ready. But you have to do your own duty, your own job. At least you have to do before you attend me. Now comes the final message of the Lord Krishna. His final message in Gitaji's last shloka, what Bhagavan is going to say. And here he summarizes the message of the Nivrutti Marga. He says, Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja aham tva sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami ma shuchah. भगवान से सर्व धर्मान परित्यज्य, रिनाउंस ऑल योर ड्यूटीज अर्जुना, ऑल योर कर्म, ऑल योर धर्म. एंड दिस वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस, दैट दिस इज बाय अंडरस्टैंडिंग, बाय द नॉलेज, बाय द आत्मज्ञान, दैट सेल्फ इज अ नॉन डूअर, इट इज अकर्ता स्वरूप, आत्मा इज अकर्ता. And with this understanding, we have to renounce all our dharma karma. Mam ekam sharanam vraja. Come only to my shelter, Bhagavan says. Ekam, just my shelter, take my shelter. Aham tva sarva papebhyah. I shall relieve you of all your papa, all your sins. Moksha ishyami. And I will give you that freedom from all the samsara chakra that you want. Moksha. I'll give you this. Ma shuchaha. Do not grieve, Arjuna. Don't worry. Definitely, if you come to my shelter, if you renounce everything, take my shelter, I'll relieve you of all the sins, make you pure, and then you will be able to get moksha. And the understanding that we need to have from these two shlokas of the summarizing of the Gitaji is that as a jiva, we are very akin to that of a river which keeps flowing through all its life, all its path. As it starts from the mountain, it keeps flowing with a lot of pravritti, and finally the destination of the river is to meet the ocean, and that is where the pravritti merges into nivritti and the river becomes one with this ocean. So the individual I, the jiva, the ahamkarta, merges into the universal consciousness. The river, it appears that the river loses its identity, but the river does not actually lose identity, becomes one with the ocean, has that eternal bliss and has that eternal vastness. And then this is what is the understanding of our jiva, of our life. So to understand the divine, the Ishvara, is also very important. And this kind of understanding, that samajhdari, is what is the crux of the essence of the understanding of Gitaji. The first understanding the Guruji teaches us is that Ishvara is the Mahakarta. He is the one who determines everything. And I am an instrument, I am a nimitta matra bhava. I have been given this duty, I have to do this kartavya, this my duties, enjoined duties, to the best of my abilities. If I understand and believe that I am the karta, I am the doer, then I must understand that Ishvara, he is the karma phala data. He gives us the results of the action. I don't have any right to determine, to have attachment towards the fruits of the action. I should do my karma in the best possible way, leave it to the rest, to the Lord, and he will give me whatever best I deserve. And that trust I must have in this system, this karma, karma phala, the system that he has created. The third understanding is that Bhagavana Ishvara is the permanent solution to all the problems. He is the Upaya Swarupa. And that's why I must pray and try to get this huge energy. So it will help me in my problems. Whenever I am faced with a problem, I should try and pray to the Lord, because he is Samartha. He is an eligible person who can relieve me all the problems and find a solution very easily from all the problems, and that I should try and do all the time as much as I can. And finally, Ishvara is what I always yearn for. I, or every one of us, we always yearn for, we want to be ever. Nobody wants to have a disease, or nobody wants to be old, nobody wants to die. We always want to be ever, we want to be Nitya, we want to be Amara. Nobody wants, everybody has a fear of death. And this is what is called as a Sat. We want to be there always. Second is, we want to know. We want to know everything, and that's why we keep reading, studying, seeing our phone, all this we keep doing, because we want to know. And Ishvara is Sarvagnya, he knows everything, he's an all-knower. And there's a Jnana Swarupa, and this is what is called as the Chit Swarupa of the Ishvara. And then we all want to be happy. Nobody of us wants dukkha at any point of time. That's why we want Nitya Sukha. And we always want Dukkha Nivruti. And this is our Anand, Ishvara's Ananda Swarupa. And only Ishvara can give us this Anand Swarupa to us. So the first step is to understand that Ishvara is the Sat Chit and the Ananda Swarupa. And this is what I yearn for all the time. And finally, we have to understand that the same Swarupa is not just Ishvara, but it is also my Swarupa. All the Jeev Swarupa is the Atma Tattva, which is Sat Chit and the Ananda Swarupa. And this understanding of this shloka can be understood from the two viewpoints, from the Sampradaya Drashti. The first is the duality, the Dvaita Sampradaya. That means, which is the Bhakti Marga, which is the devotional path followers. And these people are called the Bhakta, and they worship the form God or the incarnate God. It's called a Saguna Bhakti. The second is the non-dual path, which is called the Advaita, which is also called the Vedanta, Upanishads or the Pramana. And this, these sadhakas, these seekers are called Jignasu. They are, they yearn, their main goal is the Jnana. And through Jnana, they want to be one with the Lord. In Bhakti Marga, through devotion, they want to be one with the Lord. Finally, oneness with the Lord is important, that Jnana, that understanding. And the non-dual or the Advaita sadhakas, they worship the Nirguna Bhakti. And amongst the Advaita, there can be two ways we can understand this final shloka of the Lord. One is the means to the goal, sadhana, for Jnana Parapti. And second is the as the goal itself, the Sadhya Rupa, Swayam Jnana Drashti or the Jnana Nishta. So let us understand this shloka from the these three different viewpoints. Bhagavan says, from the dual viewpoint or the devotional or bhakti viewpoint, renouncing all duties means that we renounce all useless activities that we do day and night. Wo sab tyag karke, let us go and come to the shelter of the Lord. Sharanagati is a very important part of bhakti sampradaya. And this utmost faith, ananya shraddha, is very important so that the bhakta can do smarana, bhajana, kirtana, japa, puja. And the main purpose of all these is that his mind will become still, quiet, and then it leads to dhyana sadhana, where he can feel oneness with the Lord. And this is what is the, and with this Bhagavan says, aham tva sarva papebhya, I shall relieve you all the sins and you shall attain liberation. Moksha means you shall become one with me. And don't worry, this is the way we can understand the bhakti marga. We need to do our duty. Bhagavan is always ready to give shelter to all of us. Ramanujacharya, which was one of the proponents of the Bhakti Marga, explains how Mam Ekam can be explained in three ways. Bhagavan, he says, first, Bhagavan Mam Ekam means Bhagavan is Param Karunikam. He is the highest compassion. He has the highest compassion. He has the highest grace. Sometimes his grace may be difficult for us. It may be harsh on us occasionally. But this is also the grace of the Lord. That is what we have to understand. It is called the Kathora Krupa. And the second way of understanding the Lord is that he gives shelter to everyone, each one of us, without any distinction of caste, color, creed, sex, age, race, religion, anything. Analochita vishesha ashesha loka sharanam. Even to his enemies, he would give his sharana. He gave his sharana to Vibhishana, who was a brother of his enemy. So, like this, Bhagavan always gives shelter to everyone. His ocean of love. Ashritya Vatsalya Jaladim is like an ocean of love, and all are his children, and they're all the same. This is how we have to understand the Lord, and with this we can have bhakti or sharanagati towards the Lord. The other way of understanding the non-dual or the Advaita as the means to the goal, as a sadhana rupa, understanding the same 66 or the final shloka, renounce our duties means doing karma sannyasa. All our karma we should give up, and this is only possible in the sannyasa lifestyle. So it means karma sannyasa. Bhagavan says, come to my shelter, but just renouncing karma is not good enough. We have to do the, you know, all the jnana sadhana, shravana, manana, didityasana, and then only with this we can understand the jnana nishta, our akarta swarupa of the atma swarupa, and then it relieves us of all our sins and we shall attain liberation or moksha. We should not worry, Bhagavan says. So sannyas lifestyle is quite conducive for moksha, because it is, the only goal is to have Bhagavata Prapti. But it is not essential. Our own scriptures never say that you should do sannyasa. Pravritti dharma and nivritti dharma both have an equal importance in Gitaji. The pravritti dharma, the karma yoga, has been given much more importance. In the Upanishads, the nivritti dharma or the sannyasa may be given more importance. But Gitaji is more about our own self, the common jiva like us, for whom the pravritti lifestyle, the householder lifestyle, is also conducive to attain the highest goal of the human existence. Seeing this again, this final shloka with the Advaita Jnana Drashti, the Swayam as the goal, the Sadhya Rupa or the Swayam Jnana Drashti, we should look at the Sat Chit and the Ananda Swarupa one Tattva. Renouncing all our duties or dharma means renouncing all our identifications, all our Tadatmya, all our Upadhis that we are identified with. The first one is the bodily, the Deha Dharma, where we feel that I'm born, I undergo all the changes, I die. So I'm identified with my body. And by drashtya, drashya viveka, I must see clearly that I am the seer, I am the drashta of this body, I am not this body, I am different from this body. Similarly, Indriya Dharma, We believe that my indriya, some of them are very powerful, some are not powerful, some are mind, etc. But I can see this clearly, and that's why I must understand that I am different from all these five jnanendriyas and the five karmendriyas through which I do all my actions in this world. The mana dharma. Mana also, we feel sometimes we are quite upset, we are quite quiet, sometimes we are still, we are happy, sometimes we are sad. All these are mana dharma, and we identify ourselves, I am happy, I am sad, though I must understand that I am different from my mana, and this is how I have to see this and separately. I have to see and visualize my thoughts. Similarly, buddhi dharma, intellect, I can know a lot of things, I don't know certain things, but I am the knower, I am different from my intellect, which is storing all this information. And finally, ahankara, which renounces all these first four things. It is ahankara, it is the I-ness that renounces the bodily dharma, the indriya dharma, the mano dharma, the buddhi dharma. But that I, that ahankara, that ego, finally has to be renounced. Without that, we cannot understand or attain the divine. And that's really, we have to take the shelter of one, ek akhanda atvitiya nitya shuddha buddha atma tattva. Only this will give us the liberation, the moksha, the freedom that we all yearn for. In the next shloka, Bhagavan talks about the adhikari, the sampradaya vidhi. Whom should this knowledge be given to? Whom should it not be given to? So he describes whom should it not be given to. Idam te na tapaskaya na bhaktaya kadachana na cha shushrushave vachyam na cha mam yobhyasuyati. Bhagavan says this knowledge should not be given to a tapaskaya, one who has no austerities, tapa, in his life. A tapa is something like some kind of a self-control, self-discipline. It's a religious discipline, some kind of sanyama over our body, mind. And this, only with this sanyama, we can become from swachanda, that is completely independent. We do whatever we like. From swachanda, we become swatantra, means we become independent with a self-control. So this is the ultimate goal, to become from swachanda, go to swatantrata. But this has to be by sanyama, some kind of a austerity or tapa has to be there in our life. Bhagavan says, na abhaktaya, one who has no devotion, no bhakti. And bhakti stands for both Ishwara bhakti as well as Guru bhakti. Both has to be there. We have to have reverence and respect for our Guru, through whom we get this knowledge. And we must have a faith and devotion towards the Lord. Na cha ashushrave vachyam, one who does not want to listen to all the words, shravana, one who is not, you know, having any interest or inclination for shravana from the Guru, or Vedanta Vakya. These are the person. And the fourth is one who has asuya, nachamam ya abhyasuyati, one who has asuya, dosha buddhi, one who despises me, finding faults with me all the time, sees as durbuddhi. Then these are the persons who are not eligible candidates to listen to this knowledge. Bhagavan says we must have some kind of a tapa, self-control, some bhakti in our life, some inclination towards listening to all these divine words of Bhagavana, and absence of dosha buddhi in the Lord, having some kind of a shraddha in the Lord. So these make us eligible to understand this knowledge. Bhagavan, then the next two shlokas, he praises the person, the teacher who teaches this to the students. And ya imam paramam guhyam mat bhakteshva vidhasyati bhaktim mai param krutva mame vaishyastya sanshayah. So Bhagavan says, one who teaches this paramam guhyam, highly mystical knowledge, which is difficult to understand, that's why we require the help of a teacher who is learned. Madbhakteshu abhidhasyati, one who shares this with my devotees, understanding, making them understand the meaning of these shlokas, well, that person is doing bhaktim mai param, he is my utmost devotee, he is my parabhakta, he is doing my parabhakti, Bhagavan says. Krutva mam eshyati, and he or she shall attain me, there is no doubt about it. Bhagavan says asanshaya, there is no doubt that he will attain me, he or she who shares with my devotees all these teachings of this highly mystical knowledge will become one with me. And in the next shloka, Bhagavan again says that how much Bhagavan loves, Krishna loves the one who shares his knowledge. Nacha tasman manushyeshu kachin me priya krutta maha bhavita nacha me tasmat अन्यः प्रियतरो भुवि. Once says, Nacha Tasmat Manusheshu, out of all the persons, one who shares this message of Gita ji, Kashchit me Priyakrutta Maha is most dear to me. Anya Priyatara Bhuvi, on this earth, no one is as dear to me. And Bhavita Nacha me Tasmat, and no one in the future also shall be as dear to me as the person who shares this knowledge of Gita ji with other devotees of mine. Bhagavan says he is most dear to me. And then Bhagavan also appreciates a person who listens and recites Gita ji. Adhyeshyate cha ya imam dharmyam samvadam avayoho jnana yagnena tenaham ishtha syamiti me matihi. Bhagavan says, one who listens and recites adhyayan, adhyeshyate, adhyayan karte hai jo log, imam dharmyam samvadam. Dharmyam samvadam means this ethical, moral, and a virtuous samvada, avayoho. Avayoho means between the both of us. Bhagavan is telling Arjuna, this samvada, one who listens and recites, he is not just doing anything, but he is doing jnana yagna. He is performing a knowledge sacrifice. He is doing a jnana yagna. Tena aham ishtasyam, and that is akin to my devotion. One who listens and recites this Gita ji, the shlokas of Gita ji, is doing my bhakti. He is doing a jnana yagna. Bhagavan says, iti me matihi. This is my firm opinion. Bhagavan gives such a high reverence to people who listen and recite Gita ji. And also Bhagavan says, one who cannot read or write, for them, Shraddha vananasu yascha shunuyadapi yo naraha sopi mukta shubhan lokan prapyuyat punya karmanam. For people who cannot read or write, those people who just listen with faith, without fault finding, anasuyaha, don't find any faults, but shrunuyatapi, they just keep listening to this, Bhagavan says, api muktaha, they will also be liberated, they will also become free, shubhan lokan prapnuyat, they will attain the auspicious lokas, the higher lokas, the brahma loka, the deva loka, punya karmanam, due to their punya, due to their virtues, because reading, listening to Gita ji is also highly punyakari, there is a lot of punya along with this. And then Bhagavan is asking Arjuna, he is asking a question to Arjuna, very beautiful question. He says, does this bring any change inside you, Arjuna? You did have a moha, vishada, and shoka, all these problems you had at the beginning of the first adhyaya when Bhagavan started this teaching in the second adhyaya. Bhagavan asks, kachide chachrutam partha tvaye kagrena chetasa kachit agnana sammohaha pranashtaste dananjaya. So Bhagavan asks two questions. One, O Partha, etat shrutam tvaya ekagrane chetasa, did you listen to what I said, entire Gita ji, with a concentrated mind, ekagrata, with a concentrated mind? And then Bhagavan asks the second question, kachit agnana sammoha pranashtaste dananjaya. O Dananjaya, did your moha or your delusion, which was born out of agnana, agnana janita, the agnana utpanna, jo sammoha, jo hua tha apko, born out of ignorance, did it get destroyed? Now, and this is the acharya dharma that Bhagavan is following. Every good teacher, every good acharya, after explaining to the student, will ask him, whether did you understand? Whether whatever I said, is it clear to you? Or should I give you again? Should I repeat the message? Bhagavan is asking Arjuna this question, that whether did you listen with a concentrated mind, and whether your moha, which was born out of ignorance, did it get destroyed, and whether the purpose of the Gita ji has been fulfilled? That is the question that Bhagavan is asking, because moha was the main problem that Arjuna was facing, and Bhagavan gave all these teachings just to nivrutta, just to take away the moha delusion of Arjuna, so that he can see clearly what is the correct thing to do. And Arjuna gives a beautiful answer to this question. Arjuna says, Arjuna uvacha nashto moha sprutir labdha tvat prasadan mayachyuta sthitosmi gata sandeha karishye vachanam tava. Bhagavan Arjuna accepts and surrenders to Lord Krishna. He says, tvat prasadat maya achyuta, ho Krishna, achyuta, achyuta is the name of Krishna, who does not chyuta, does not derelict from any of his duties, is always always perfect in his work. He is the Purna Purushottama, is the full perfection. Krishna, with your grace, Nashta Moha. Bhagwan Arjuna says, Bhagwan, my Moha, my delusion has been completely destroyed now. And Smriti Labdhva, my senses, I have come back to my original sense, my Sthiti, my Smriti has come back, my Swarupa Sthiti has come back. I know what I am now. Clearly, Sthita Asmi Gata Sandeha. I am now steady in my sense, and this is without doubt. I am quite Sthita. Karishye Vachanam Tava. And now I shall do whatever you say, Bhagwan. Arjuna accepts, Lord. He says, yes, your job is done. The purpose of Gita ji is served. My moha has been destroyed, Arjuna says. And with your grace, I have come back to my sthiti, my swarupa, my state. I have re-established that state. And I have no doubt that I shall now do whatever you tell me to do. I will do it. And then finally, in the last few shlokas, the four or five shlokas of the Gita ji, Sanjaya concludes the Gita ji. As we remember, he started it too after the question of Dhritarashtra. Sanjaya started the Gita ji. And now Sanjaya is concluding the Gita ji. He says, Sanjaya uvacha ityaham vasudevasya parthasya cha mahatmanaha samvadamimam shrausham adbhutam roma harshanam. So Sanjaya is saying now, this is how ityaham vasudevasya parthasya, I heard the dialogue between Sri Krishna and Mahatmana Arjuna. Parthasya, the great Arjuna. Arjuna is also called Mahatmana because he was the most eligible candidate to listen to this beautiful teaching of the Lord. Samvadam, the dialogue, Imam Ashrosham, I could hear this, and this was a beautiful Samvada between the two Sakha, the Premis, the Bhakta, and the Guru, Shishya, between Arjuna and Krishna. And Bhagwan Sanjaya says that this was adbhutam, this was extraordinary, this was an unbelievable advice, or this was the unbelievable teaching, that Samvada dialogue that I heard. And he says, Roma Harshanam, and it was so thrilling, I have my goosebumps now. It is very, very thrilling to hear this Samvada. And then Sanjaya thanks Veda Vyasji for this divine opportunity that was given to him. Vyasa Prasada Chrutvana Etad Guhyamayam Param Yogam Yogeshwarat Krishnat Sakshat Kathayatah Swayam. Says Vyasa Prasadat Shrutvan, with the grace of Ved Vyas, as we remember, Ved Vyas provided the Divya Chakshu to Sanjay so he could see and listen to all this that was happening on the battlefield of Mahabharata, Dharma Kshetre, Kuru Kshetre. And then he was relaying this to the king Dhritarashtra, his entire divine song of the Lord. It is also called Bhagavad Gita. Etad Guhyam, which was a very hidden secret, a mystical secret, the teaching of the Lord that was given to Arjuna, which was Param, which is the highest and the best message ever given, the Shrestha Samvada. Yogam, which is also a solution to all the problems. It is a yoga sadhana. It is a upaya because it contains all the karma yoga, bhakti yoga, jnana yoga, dhyana yoga, raja vidya, raja yoga, all these different kinds of yoga are there, samatva yoga. And that's why these are all the upaya, the solutions to all our daily problems. Aham Yogeshwarat Krishnat Sakshat Kathayata Swayam. And I heard this message from none other than Krishna himself, who is the Yogeshwara, who is the Lord of the Yoga. And Swayam Krishna told this message to Arjuna, and it was my great fortune, Sanjay says. He again expresses his joy that he was very, very fortunate to listen to this message. In the next shloka, Rajan Sansmrutya Sansmrutya Samvadamimam Adbhutam Keshavarjuna Yoh Punyam Pashyamicha Muhur Muhuhu. He says, O King Dhritarashtra, he says, Rajan, Sansmrutya Sansmrutya, remembering this wonderful dialogue again and again, Imam Adbhutam, this beautiful, wondrous, wonderful dialogue between Keshava and Arjuna, between Krishna and Arjuna, he says, Punyam, which provides a lot of punya, it takes away a lot of papa of the jiva, Rashyami cha muhur muhuhu. I again and again, I'm overjoyed, I'm so happy, and I'm so fortunate that I could get this opportunity to listen this firsthand from Lord Krishna himself. And then in the next shloka, Sanjay again enchantingly remembers the Vishwarupa Darshana that he got into in the 11th Adhyaya. Tachya sansmrutya sansmrutya rupam atyadbhutam harehe vismayo me mahan rajan rashyami cha punah punah. He says, recollecting that wondrous, that adbhuta rupa of Bhagavana, that Vishwarupa, again and again he says, vismaya me mahan rajan, oh great king, I'm greatly astonished by remembering this, recollecting this wondrous form of Bhagavan, the Vishwarupa. Again and again, I'm feeling so thrilled again and again. He says he has no words. And finally, in the last shloka of the Gitaji, the 78th shloka, Sanjay concludes the Gitaji by stating a fact, a matter of fact, with Dhritarashtra to open his eyes. Of course, he's blind, but maybe gives him an opportunity, a chance that he still awakens from his moha, his antakara, and takes the right decision. He says, yatra yogeshwara krishna yatra partho dhanurdhara tatra shrir vijayo bhuti truvanitirmatir mama. Sanjay says, yatra yogeshwara krishna, where there is lord of the yoga, yogeshwara krishna, yatra partho dhanurdhara, where there is an archer like Arjuna, who is an ace archer, tatra shri vijaya bhuti dhruvaniti hi, that alone is wealth. Shri is wealth, vijaya is victory, bhuti is all different kinds of siddhis, vibhutis, accomplishments, dhruvaniti hi, dhruva means always renari, matlab nitya, focused strategy which is eternal, matir mamaha, this is my firm opinion. Sanjay concludes saying that wherever there is Krishna, wherever there is Bhagavana, and wherever there is Arjuna, there alone is victory. He wants to open the eyes of Arjuna, Dhritarashtra was keen to avoid further destruction. However, still Dhritarashtra did not say anything. His moha could not be destroyed, and he allowed this war to continue, because remember, this was the 10th day of the Mahabharata Yuddha when Gitaji was being relayed to Dhritarashtra by Sanjaya, how we hear it again. But this was in vain, because the Mahabharata, as we know, went on and on. And this final shloka also explains to us that our efforts are very important. Archer like Arjuna is there, he makes his best efforts. And of course, where there is yoga Krishna, where there is the grace of the Almighty, when both these combine together, success and all types of accomplishments are definitely going to be got. With this, we come to the end of this Adhyaya. Om Tat Sat Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gitasu Upanishatsu Brahma Vidhyayam Yoga Shastre Shri Krishna Arjuna Samvade Moksha Sanyasa Yogo Nama Ashtadashodhyayah Atha Shri Bhagavad Gita Samaptam. It is customary that at the end of the Gitaji, we recite the first shloka of the Gitaji. The purpose is that we will keep revising the Gitaji off and on, and that's why Dhritarashtra uvacha dharma kshetre kuru kshetre samaveta yuyutsavah mamakah pandavashchaiva kimakurvata sanjaya Guru Brahma Guru Vishnu Gurur Devo Maheshwara Gurur Sakshat Parah Brahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.